those terms, I think it's important to remember that the future is not an unknown land into which we totter unsteadily one day at a time, but something we're all in the act of creating. Not something we're going to, but something that we're building. Just as the Australia in which we live today has been shaped by the decisions and actions of us and previous generations, so we, by our decisions and actions, are determining what the Australia of the 21st century will be like. And in those terms, whether or not we achieve the goal of ecologically sustainable development is largely in our hands. It is a matter of what decisions we take and what actions we take. In those terms, I want to remind you that this Earth is the only home we have and the only home we're ever likely to have. There's no realistic prospect of mass rescue by friendly aliens or mass migration to another part of the cosmos. We will determine what environmental state Australia is in the future, what environmental state the world is in the future.
What have we said? We are the world's largest on-the-ground aid agency, far and away. We have hundreds of times more projects than the United Nations, the FAO, WHO, and all the official aid agencies combined. We don't own a single four-wheel drive double cab Toyota. Every other aid agency has at least 1,000 each of those, and we don't have anyone on salary. Nobody's on salary. So to beat us, they can't beat us. They've got to have a salary. FAO, you get $550 an hour. No one's going to give that up and go and live in the dust with us. We have no competition. The world is ours.
Permaculture is quite an interesting concept because we're actually quite unstructured. Groups around the world tend to get together in regional and local areas, and some of the people are working in very, very isolated situations, in very difficult situations at times, and it becomes very important for them to have the opportunity to network and to network the strategies and share the design strategies and share information with other people from other regions, other climatic zones, and just generally get some sense of support for what they're doing. Really, I think coming together in this way really encourages people, gives them new energy, and they can go back into their region and work knowing that there's a whole global network of support behind them. This is the 6th International Permaculture Conference. They're held roughly every second or third year, and in the past there's been one held in Australia previously, somewhere in New South Wales. There's been one in the United States, New Zealand, Nepal, Scandinavia, and now back to Australia and in Perth here in Western Australia.
I think they've taken up all my time. Facilitator has actually managed to fill in the last of it. This happens every time we won't get any lectures. I have half an hour, so I'd appreciate it if you wave your arms at me 5 minutes short of half an hour. Let's look at the etymology. Permanens is a Latin word meaning to endure or to persist throughout. And culture is any activity, any of those activities that support and distinguish human communities. Probably the easiest way to understand it is there are subsets of culture like agriculture. When I say the word agriculture, you think, oh, that's the activity which produces food for the community. And you'd be wrong. Agriculture is that activity which produces commodities for the international market. So agriculture, although it may originally have been intended to feed us, no longer does, and it basically operates in response to a remote commodity market. And that's what sets the prices, and that's what sets the demand. And very few people own the seeds they plant. If they're hybrid seeds, no point in trying to keep them either. So agriculture then was intended to feed us. It no longer is so intended. Very little human food is grown in agriculture. And 90% of some of our crops go to animal feeds. It's possible to drive through Europe. I did recently go through on a train, which is much more relaxing than driving. I took a note of all the food growing on the farms. I found 5 acres of potatoes between Copenhagen and Switzerland. Very little food is grown on farms today. Mainly it's forage for animals. And fortunately that's backfiring. You can get mad cow disease from cows, and you can get vancomycin resistant enterococci from chickens and pork. It's food produced by agriculture is becoming truly unsafe to eat. There's a great word, it's called agricologic disease. Those diseases which you have caused by the operations of agriculture, the other disease rapidly spreading as a result of modern agriculture is the fact that you're all turning into women. That doesn't worry women too much. The alligators down in Florida, they've got tiny little penises, no good to anybody, no better than a wart really, and they don't have any testes, and it's really happened to the Danes and a few other groups of people as well. So that the number of males being born with a penile deformities is large, with testicular cancer, that's a growing thing, and they don't have any sperm to speak of, or at least none that are the right shape and kick around. 85% of sperm in some areas is deformed. So this is due to agriculture also, because it's pouring hormones and hormone analogues onto the soil and includes it in the food of the chickens, pigs and cattle. Because feminizing chickens is a good thing. In the old days they cut open the male's backs and remove the testes. Now they just feminize them. So when you go to Colonel Sanders or Kentucky Fried Chicken, by all means lick your fingers, but don't eat the chicken. Waving your arm, there's 5 minutes to go.
I know.
Permaculture was born in reaction to this mess. It subsumes organic agriculture. We just assume that we'll grow food cleanly. It doesn't use sprays or hormones or all these things. So I'm pleased to tell you there are 9 people in Scandinavia with a full head of sperm. They're all organic gardeners. I advise them to hide. I think I might have too, but I don't want to test it. I don't want to be a target. I told them, you guys are better get out of here. You're not going to be able to cope. Yeah. Well, and then it's an eerie thing that all the books on permaculture up to the 1970s were on garden tips. Plant your beans 6 inches apart, 1.5 inches deep. They were, every book on agriculture was on garden tips. There was no design. And when I realised that in the late 60s, the hair went up on the back of my head. Nobody told farmers or gardens how to design for eliminating bad effects of climate and wind. You can take out frost, you can take out wind by the correct plantings, and nothing was related to anything else. So we didn't have any books on the design of agricultural systems, and I wrote the first one, I think, of that in 78. There were no precursors. There was a little book on design and landscape by P.A. Yeomans in Australia on water design and landscape. There were no other books on design. Dimension was recently added to design by Masanobu Fukuoka in Japan, who collapsed time. He planted his crop into the remains of the preceding crop. So he didn't have a crop, plow, reseed, start another crop. So he was able to get many crops more. And that's the last word that's been issued on design. There may be other dimensions to design yet to come. And now we've started the process of issuing books on design. There'll be a lot smarter people amongst our students than we are, and if they're not, they're pretty damn silly. So permaculture is a book on design, and that's overlooked. I think most people in the media think it's a book on gardening. It's a very sad backward step indeed. If I get on talkback, nobody asks me serious questions. They ask me about why their lemon tree leaves are going yellow. And we know why that is. They planted it in a boggy place or they don't give it enough urine. So there's a way out. Lift it up, piss on it. So that's what permaculture is about. It's very common sense. It's in response to larger changes in the rational economic control system, which is being imposed more and more upon us. It's an attempt to return to a systems from small gardens. I will point out now, the gardens some in many countries produce nearly 90% of the food. Agriculture was true of Russia. Agriculture produces very little food. It does the most destruction. It has the most land. It doesn't produce much food that people actually eat. Gardens do. So if you can increase your gardens, you can get rid of agriculture. And luckily, I think in the near future, it should be a banned activity. Agriculture is the most destructive activity on the face of the earth. It's responsible for poisoning 60% of our water supplies and eroding most of our landscape. Mining is a minor activity compared to agriculture when it comes to soil destruction. And we can't lose much more soil in Australia. And if you look at the number of acres of land available per head plotted over the last century, it's in steep decline. We hardly have any land left upon which to grow food. And for the coming year, we're 45 days short of food. The year ahead. So you're running into real problems. The more soil scientists we've trained, the more land we have lost. Had a soil scientist the other day said she couldn't get a job. I said, you've saved hundreds of acres of erosion. But if you don't know what permaculture is now, you'll have to ask somebody. It's a design of systems with which we can live.
As part of the conference, we've included some a number of field trips. We've looked at urban sites that have been designed, and following our 4 days of workshops and presentations, we took people throughout the southwest of the state to look at the various strategies that are being used in broadacre design, to look at, in particular, at the difficulties with salinity that we experience in this country. Then there were other field trips that focused on the smaller design process, and there were some very good examples. People were quite excited by some of the examples that they saw, and they, even if the conditions were quite different from where they came from, there are many small things that they can take out of that and adapt to their own situation. So there were many excited visions developed during that period.
I'm actually an electrician by trade. I was working out in the goldfields, building, believe it or not, gold mines. And I worked out there for a couple of years when I met the person I co-owned the farm with, who had done a permaculture design course back in 1986. And he started telling me, as we were building transformer rooms together, all about permaculture. And I thought, yes, that's what I want to do. So he ended up talking me into buying half of this farm with him. And we continued to work on the gold mines, and all we used to do every day was talk about how we're going to design this farm. So we actually designed this farm when we were living in the goldfields. When I finally came to Geraldton, after learning quite a bit about native plants and seeds, which I actually started picking seeds and using that, that was my main income when I first came here, because once we paid for the farm, we're totally broke again. So we had to look at a nice ethical way to make money. So we went out and started picking seeds. Initially, I knew nothing about plants or the Geraldton climate. So initially, everything was an experiment. The amount of plants and effort that I put into getting the place growing was tremendous compared to what you actually see on the ground now. Most of the time here has been making mistakes. I think maybe 3% of what I've done is what you're actually seeing now. It's the sands here are white. I've got hardly any nutrients. They're non-wetting soils. Water is an expensive resource. We're fortunate enough to have scheme water running past us, but we've also gone and we've got 30,000 gallons worth of rainwater catchment now, but that only does the nursery and the house. We've set up a nursery. We decided a lot of the plants that we needed to grow here weren't available locally. They all come up from Perth, and Perth, even then, they weren't available in Perth either. So I spent a lot of time collecting seed of useful plants and propagating it, spending sometimes a year growing it from seedling and then planting it out, and often it would die in the first 3 days over 40 degrees. So it's pretty heartbreaking when you've nursed things from seed. And sometimes I'd spend you spend months and months and months sourcing seeds. Back in the early days, I might plant them out and come back the next in a couple of days and we'd have a locust plague and they'd come through and eat them all. But it wasn't one thing or another. It wasn't the heat, it might be the insects. It wasn't the insects, it might be the geese, because we got geese here in the early days and we didn't set up for them properly. Once we actually set up to protect things from all the wildlife, you come out and you might find the white ants have decided that's a great plant to eat. So, yeah, it's quite a difficult one. It's not one thing, it's another. I spend the odd time disheartened, but it usually only lasts for a day, and then I boost back into energy again and get another wonderful idea to try out. Up to about 3 years ago, I spent most of my time here with one other person who's no longer involved. But fortunately, 3 years ago, I joined an organisation called WOOF. Now, WOOF stands for Willing Workers on Organic Farms. And what it is people who are travelling, quite often international people, they join this organisation, and what happens, they can come and live with you on the farm. And they will come and stay in return for, and they will help you work. And in return for their work, you teach them, in my case, about permaculture, and you feed them and give them somewhere to sleep and cater for their needs while they're with you. So I get to meet a tremendous amount or diversity of people coming through, and it's wonderful because you're always getting new ideas. Quite often you'll be trying to solve a problem or figure out a way to do something, and you've thought about it so hard, you spiral yourself into a corner virtually. And when you get other people come in, quite often they can see things very clearly, and sometimes the simplest word allows you to go, yes, that's it, well, I didn't see it before. they're just blinded by too much thought. So people are quite, it's really valuable having input from other people. And it's, the best bit about it is that it's like travelling without having to travel. What I'm planning to do here, what I'm in the process of, is to set up an educational facility. Whether it actually becomes an official institute or not, I don't know. But I've done a huge amount of work in the drylands and developed a huge amount of different techniques to make, allow things to grow here. And for me and all the work, my aim is for it to get out to people in the local area so they can use it. Now, one thing I've learned about permaculture, it's very easy to come become famous out of your own community. Like, you only have to do something pretty small and you run around and tell everyone what you've done at your own place and they think, wow, the whole of Geraldton's like that. But the joke of it is, quite often you might be the only person in the whole of Geraldton does it and you might not even know your neighbours. So what I'm hoping to do is get it out to the local people where it really matters. Like, I've just published a book. And, like, the best bit about the book is I've sold 100 copies of them within 2 months of it being published with hardly, with two local newspaper articles to the local people. And, like, I fine-tuned the book for local people. And finally, the knowledge is out there to the people who can actually use it. Now, I sell a lot of these books internationally as well. And unfortunately, a lot of them go into people's libraries and they sit there and it goes, oh, I've got the best collection of permaculture books in the world. But they don't get used. They don't really count there. Where it all counts is here. But my aim is when I finally get the buildings done, is to be able to house people here for 2 weeks at a time, like up to 30 people here, and have them all using different styles of compost toilets and show, and have them all having showering under different types of appropriate technology, you know, solid different showers, and just having demonstrations but practical, everything being appropriate to the area, and also showing people that it's not lowering the standard of living either. So many people think back to basics. Well, it's not back to basics, it's forward to sustainability. And, like, let's live a high standard of living and be, let it be sustainable. Let's tread lightly on the earth. I want to put a course together, a dry land course, and specialise in, like, living rather than bombarding people with heaps of information that's not relevant to their climate or having to, they go off. Quite often, I find with permaculture design courses, people have been bombed with so much information that when they actually walk out, they're dizzy. They just put it all aside because it's just too much. They don't know where to go, they don't know where to start. And one day I want to get the building spaces bigger so I can have more people living in here. I've set the whole infrastructure up. I reckon I could just have 10 different things going here and have people fully employed.
When the Vietnamese surrendered, they did it big. And they asked me, could they copy my book, Introduction to Permaculture? I said, sure. I said, what do you want for that? I said, it's yours. I know you've had a rough time lately and this just might make might make you feel a little better. They printed $150,000, gave one to every farmer in Vietnam and said, this is the way forward. And now, you know, it's official policy. It was what you call a window of opportunity. Having just whipped the pants off the Americans, the Cambodians, the French, the Chinese and somebody else. They said they were fighting five wars at once. They're feeling pretty good, but they had their structure still in order. They had their regional commanders, their generals, their troops. So when permaculture, Introduction to Permaculture, went down the line in Vietnamese, that said, just stick something in their mouth. And it's possible to walk from Saigon to Hanoi through permaculture now, and very good stuff too. And a few months ago, somebody said, could I go up and help the Vietnamese? And I said, I'll see. So I rang up Mr. Mann. I said, you want any help? He said, nope. So we're good at it, got our own teachers, shove off. Yeah, so that's fantastic. That's what one person can do. That person was Roe Morrow, took Vietnam single-handedly. The Americans should sign her on.
One of the big things that permaculture has been useful for has been in countries that have immediately suffered war. But one of the difficult things is that you just can't go in there and arrive and say, here I am and teach a course, because you probably don't know the language, and also there is probably no interpreter. There might be someone who speaks English, but they may not know anything about a soil or a plant or an earthworm. For example, in one country I went to, the people had never heard of microorganisms in the soil. And when they had a long discussion, which I thought was about microorganisms, they were discussing whether it was true that there could be such a thing as a microorganism. So you can't take anything much for granted. And the next thing is, if you can spend time to get material about permaculture translated, because if you imagine what it's like to do a course and not have one follow-up document, perhaps we're telling lies. Perhaps I've come here with fanciful ideas that have got no backing. Or perhaps people forget, and afterwards they think, I missed that, I want to read it, I want to know about that. So things like getting some materials in the language, however crudely done. We got some very young agriculture students to translate essential stuff into Cambodian. That meant some budget. The other thing we had to do was to provide food because the people were hungry, so we provided breakfast. They used to eat, now listen, and maybe I'm exaggerating, but about 7 kilograms of bananas and biscuits between meals each day. If we didn't give them meals, they couldn't study because they were hungry. And they didn't only come for the meal, but oh, when there was food, they needed it. We had to provide, after the course, we had to have some money to set up a centre to grow the vegetables we were talking about. We took the 20 hardiest vegetables in the country and tried to get the seed and the cuttings and everything happening because there were no resources. I can teach a course here in Swan Lee and everyone can rush off the local garden centre and buy everything. However, if there is nothing because of decimation, you have to start and input the resources, because it's a bit like promising and not delivering. And then people don't have really any idea in their head what it's going to look like, so you really must work with them to design the first one. People are often very passive because they have lost their sense of power. If you come out of a war or things like long embargo, you really believe that somehow it's your fault. In some countries, people would even think it's their karma. They can't think what they've done because they're just ordinary peasant people living. But in somehow, there's that sense that they've brought it on themselves. Now, that means in addition to the course, I actually teach some trust building. And if it's been civil war, I teach team building, but nothing threatening. I wouldn't ask anyone to tell their story, for example, because I wouldn't know the person over there, their cousin was Khmer Rouge, that killed this person's brother, for example, and that can happen. But things like, where would you like to be in 5 years? What would you like for your family? And you have to be careful to say family in case all the children were killed. And so taking care, but also building cohesion, building support, and building it around something really impartial. We build it around a garden. Now the government will be political, the local people will be political. Almost any topic, religion will be political, whoever sided with whom and what did that pagoda work with. So what you've got is this awful ground that you can't really touch because you can't fix it up. You're not a social worker, and maybe social workers wouldn't be any good either because it's such a different experience. I think there's a lot more you could say about people of war. There are no seats, there's no chalk, there's no duster, there's one sheet of paper locked up in a cupboard they'll give you. So have you got any paper? One sheet. So it means in the courses we do buy a notebook and pencil, and they treasure them and write so small so they can save so many pages take home. It's changed since I first went, and I really think that our work in permaculture in Cambodia and Vietnam is pretty close to finished, because it's now carried by Vietnamese and Cambodian teachers. They are capable, they are good. It's something that, I think it's offered them something that's totally relevant. You could be involved in development work. If I were teaching nutrition and there's no food, as people go out to do, it is not relevant. It's sometimes not relevant to teach people skills. If there's no electricity, you can't be an electrician. If there's no money to pay you, you can't be a carpenter. But something you can actually go out and establish, and with that is the confidence. I can remember so clearly the person who said to me, I thought if I put seed in the ground it wouldn't die, but now I believe. So in a sense, permaculture does what everyone says. You give a person a fish and they eat for a day, you give them a fishing line, teach them to fish, but in this case it's a balanced diet. And the other thing to remember, people who are still in a war zone live with tremendous fear. And you can make a very safe classroom for a little while. Probably no one will come in with an AK-47 and mow you down. That night, they may have to run to the rice field and sleep there if the house is going to be burnt. They all have trap doors. On the road, maybe they'll be held up by armed soldiers. But for those few hours, you can give them company and interest. For them, education is a total luxury. So really trying to give them the smorgasbord of balanced information, and it's not talking head, they work on what I know about a soil and what we know about plants and making plant lists. But even so, you top up. You know, when you do that, it has to be to the highest capacity. Permaculture principle that you can give, I think, because any less is going to be a hindrance. If you say they'll have food on the table in 6 months, they must. Or they don't believe.
I think we need to start looking at ourselves closely. Take the Danish experience. All their fish died. They say the Skagerrak, is it, between Denmark and Sweden, died. It turned upside down, they said. Before it did, we could walk across the backs of the herring, and now there are no herring. Thousands of tons of lobsters were washed ashore dead. Our fish disappeared. We wondered, was it minerals or chemicals from our freshwater system that was killing our sea? So we started to measure the freshwater system, and we put down 30 substances that we knew we were releasing in agriculture that might have killed the sea. By the time they got, this is the Dane, got to the 9 substances that already found they shouldn't be drinking any of their water. But they had no other water. They haven't even got, you know, to the 20 substances. There are no longer any doubt that their agriculture killed their fishery. Our agriculture is going to kill the Pacific. The release of heavy metals in concentrated sulfuric acid from the cane fields of the Tweed River is 300,000 times greater than the release of sulfur from all the industries we have in Australia. Agriculture is not a small polluter. It is the major polluter of ecosystems. And when you've got pH 1.9 flowing out the river's clear and green, you better not jump in as you turn into charcoal. With it is a heavy load of aluminium, mercury, cadmium and lead. And that's too much for the Pacific. I mean, I make a lot of jokes, but I'm a very angry man. You have to be suicidally angry to do what I've done. To go from country to country and keep dodging the bullets, you know. But it works. Don't think love drives me. Hate drives me. This is no Christian movement. It's just a... It's a movement of people disgusted with fools who are screwing the earth, their earth. Of people with children and grandchildren who don't want that sort of to be remembered as being the people who screwed the earth. That's the sort of people sitting here. We don't want that. And there's no system established that can change it. So we have to change it.
Yeah, I've been very fortunate, actually, being able to acquire land in Denmark some 11 years ago. I paid very little for 60 acres of land and 45 acres of forest. And basically, I didn't have any money after that to do very much at all. I went into the design process after I'd done a permaculture course with Bill, but any implementation was just out of the question because there was no money available at all. So we left the land fairly fallow, other than taking branches of trees out of the forest and chucking them around, knowing that they had seed pods on. And it's the effect of that has caused the place to regenerate. We've got a lot of trees now growing where there was just cow pasture before. The clover and the pasture have virtually disappeared in most areas. Kikuyu tends to persist a little bit, but not really dramatically. In the last 4 years, we've been able to implement quite a considerable amount of the design that we put together and modified it, of course, as we go along, depending on things that happen on the block and, of course, the finances that are available at the time. We've put in several dams. We've got our water systems in this area pretty well sorted out now. Most of the design implementation as far as what's going to happen where is decided. We're working towards an eco-village on this side of the block. And we've also been granted $78,000 to build a herb dryer. We run totally on solar power as far as the house is concerned. We're very proud of that because we do it at a very minimum cost. And we pump water with solar power. And we've got a hydraulic ram. We've got a Shinampa system in. We're going to build a commercial nursery. And we're going to continue teaching at the same rate as we've been teaching up until now. And we're very pleased with our last 10, 11 years. We've been able to go out into the community, local community, and also go as far as Esperance, Kalgoorlie, and north of Perth, teaching permaculture to people who want to know. And the people who want to know are getting more and more and more every day, and that's a real blessing. Yeah, Living Waters gets visited by hundreds of people every year. They come to see what we're doing. A lot of them come for a few days. Some stay for a few months, and that's really good. And the amount of help we have available to us has been such a blessing, because it's not always easy to find people who are like-minded enough to be able to do and work on the projects that you are involved in. Consequently, woofers come, they want to learn, we're happy to teach them, and there's a plus-plus situation. Everybody's happy when we part company, and we've been able to network with people all over the world. This World Conference has been something very good for us too. We've been visited by lots of people who've come down on the tour, and we've also got other people coming after the tours, and the Convergence is all over. We've got a lot of people going to come and camp and stay, and I would imagine we'll probably have quite a lot of people here between now and Christmas, or now and the end of January, and looks like it's going to be a lot of fun. We are in the process of doing quite a lot of building, of course, on here. We want to build this solar herb dryer, we want to build accommodation for students and allow people to have access to this permaculture project. So we've decided that one of the ways that we can help demonstrate more ecological ways of milling and more ecological ways of making bricks and making brick buildings, we've networked with a fellow in town who has a mill, and he's a member of Living Waters Permaculture Foundation. Now he comes up here and mills any trees that we've got laying on the ground, or trees that are diseased and need to be taken down. We also bring timber in from other sites that have been cleared, and he mills it for us, and we stockpile the timber. It's been really good. We've actually sold quite a lot of timber, which has given us a bit of an income, and we've also stockpiled a lot of timber that we can use in the future. Thick slabs of jarrah, pine, yellow tingle, which is a very rare timber, and this is all done on site on a mill that's very portable, a thing that can be taken into the forest, and instead of having huge machinery going in, this mill actually goes in on men's shoulders and wheelbarrow, so it's very gentle, very soft technology. We're also using a contractor who has a very innovative system of making mud bricks, and a very quick system. They make 100 bricks an hour, so if you get a 8-hour day out of them, which is not impossible, you're up for 1,000 bricks. They have done 1,200 in a day, but there's really no point in stressing yourself for an extra 200 bricks. But the system is very innovative. It creates a brick that is nice to look at. It doesn't look as if it's been mass-produced. And like I say, it's very quick. Not only do these contractors make the bricks, but they will lay them for you as well at a very reasonable rate. It's a little cheaper than round earth. It's certainly cheaper than Midland brick. And the net result is a much more ecologically sound looking building. It's got a lot of thermal mass. It'll last for thousands of years probably. And they appeal to people in this area. We've got lots of ideas about improving both of these systems and also creating other systems for helping people make things from themselves. Compost and toilets, we're developing systems where people can make compost and toilets very easily out of off-the-shelf materials, and we can't all afford to buy the health department approved ones, and some of the ones that are made by people for themselves are unique, and they look good and they're pleasant to be in, and that's saying a lot for a toilet. The toilets that we've built here, the experimental one, we've had people actually want to go up there and live. And two German girls came and stayed here, and they lived in there all the time they were here. They loved it. So toilets can be multifunction and all. And ours is, of course, ours is going to be a power station. It's going to contain all the hot water system. It's going to contain the electrical power supply system from the solar panels. And like I said, one day we hope to put a methane digester in there as well, and hope that the whole lot doesn't go sky high. No cigarettes down the pond.
Nobody can do anything unless there's a way to do it, right? Our job has always been to make the way to do it. You know, if you disagree with the present tertiary system of education, you set up an academy that teaches what you think ought to be taught, how it ought to be taught. You don't go around belly aching about the universities. They have become totally irrelevant. They're irrelevant. You don't have to defeat them or rush them or club them or shoot them. They just die of themselves. But what you have to have is some systems that you really think you approve of going for when they die. The money system will die too. Better you're in a let system now, practicing going without a bank, than, you know, have nothing ready at all when there's no money system. And better we have our own bank. Our job has always been to make the way out.
I just want to share a little of why I'm motivated to work with children and why I see schools as an appropriate arena to do that. Children are the future caretakers of our planet, even though if children are surveyed, mostly they say they don't see that there's a planet to take care of. They see it rapidly in decline. But children have the capacity, given responsibility, tools and the ability to be creative, to completely design age appropriate and to learn the elements and techniques of design, like gardening, like swales, like appropriate technology. And in my observation and experience, it's a completely underrated. Schools are really not utilised nearly enough for bringing children into that role of responsibility as our future caretakers and leaders. So what we've been looking at in the last couple of days in a Children in Permaculture and Schools workshop is things like sister schools, how we can exchange information between schools of similar climatic zones in the two-third world and the one-third world, so that we can really know a lot more about each other, appreciate each other's cultures, and so that the financial resources can flow from the schools and children that have access to finance, even with their own little projects with fundraising, to those that don't have funds. And so this networking day, which we're just talking about, is being representatives from many countries in the world, and we're finding that even though we're very different, we have a lot of common ground, and globally there is a tremendous amount of work being done with permaculture in the curriculum, permaculture, practical application, whole design of school grounds, and involvement of parents and communities. So it was interesting for me to come now across to this permaculture conference and meet with people from Australia, New Zealand, United States, Britain, who are also working with permaculture in schools, but their orientation is more on nature conservation, on bringing indigenous trees and ground cover into the school grounds to make it more beautiful, and to give places for children to just be quiet and retreat, or perhaps for environmental education outdoors. Whereas the need in Africa is urgent. It's the need for producing food, for having shade trees, even as classrooms for children to learn under, for having water, for say doing swales in the playground, for capturing water so we can plant trees, and harvesting water from the roofs because the children don't have water to drink in many cases. So it's a very different need, and it's a very different scale, and we're working with in Africa thousands upon thousands of children and families, whereas here it's usually one small community.
One of the great amusing sights in Africa is me talking to bushmen. They'll teach me painfully a couple of words, like, I can't say the words they teach me, actually. There's a tree called, some people call it Makeri, some people call it Mongongo. Its real name is Mkwakwa. And if you say it clearly, your tongue curls up and falls down your throat. And you can't breathe. You can't breathe. And the sort of people who are saying these things are called Ungwa. I can bring tears to everybody's face by speaking bushman. They fall on the ground, they don't half laugh, they just roll all over the place, hold them on their belly, and tears stream from their eyes. And every one of them can sing, Daddy was a keeper of Edison Light. So instead of teaching them Bible or something like that, I teach them to sing sea shanties, to cast doubts on anthropological findings.
I was working in Lesotho for the last 2 years. Lesotho is a small mountainous kingdom which is completely landlocked by the country of South Africa. and it has a lot of problems of erratic rainfall, soil erosion, unemployment and poverty. I was teaching permaculture in Lesotho, working with schools, community organizations, an information network, farmers, and agriculture extension agents. When I started teaching permaculture in Lesotho, I realized that people weren't really understanding what I was talking about. And I started to develop a way of working with principles that was very practical and concrete, using a lot of examples, a lot of physical movement, and looking at the land. And then having worked with this way of teaching principles and started to work more with farmers, I realized that there's a need for a framework to fit these principles into design. A design process that would involve looking at goals, looking at the roles of people in an organization, looking at the resources that people had, and looking at what they wanted, then how to get there with permaculture, how to get there sustainably. While I was in Lesotho, I taught on 5 formal courses and then worked with a lot of people in much more informal training through going to schools, going to farms, basically talking about design and ecological principles. And of course, part of permaculture is design redundancy. And I've now left people in Lesotho who can train in Lesotho quite happily getting on with their own work and actually developing permaculture much more suited to their needs in their language. The land is much more sustainable now in the areas we were working in because due to an increased understanding of ecological processes and design, people are using less chemicals and actually working on soil erosion, stopping soil erosion and increased water harvesting. It's rather a good feeling to leave people working and quite happily getting on with things now that I'm gone. When I return to the UK, I should be interested in looking at the initiatives being taken by local permaculture groups to get involved in Local Agenda 21, which is a directive set by the Earth Summit in Rio that councils should actually be looking at participatory design to actually come up with a sustainable plan for their areas. And I think that this directive and the initiatives being taken in Britain to actually involve permaculture designers in local councils and in decisions being made by local government has a lot of application for other countries, including Southern Africa, to actually get permaculture and sustainable design into local government and then back out into areas that need it.
We have become in the modern world a little reticent to get involved in community activities which don't have a benefit for our own selves. The idea of selfless service has actually been moved to one side as I'll do that later when I retire. I'll do that when I've gained what I need individually, rather than seeing selfless service as actually a means to gain our own fulfillment. And so government at the moment is in a sense reflecting very much probably the individual driven process of getting as much as we can in as short a period of time, and if in fact in doing that to go into a deficit, both a deficit in terms of capital, what we have left as part of our land resources, but also in our thinking process, that we actually are no longer in front with our thinking, we've actually dropped behind. So people say, well, the government doesn't really think like we do now. The government is behind rather than, you know, out there leading us. The government's become reactive rather than proactive. Possibly it reflects our own thinking processes as well. So we need to become more proactive. Government now is starting to realise the need to be visionary. What makes it difficult though is that government isn't necessarily made up of our true elders in the community and true wisdom. So we need to ensure that the wisdom that is universal starts to permeate back through our hierarchical systems. And so therefore a lot of decisions are going to need to be made in a sense outside of government, but will be brought into the framework of government to actually adjust the decision making to make it more equitable and more powerful, more empowering for people. Government's interesting, isn't it? Yeah. We can avoid making decisions by giving it to one or two people, then complain that the decisions they made weren't appropriate for us. What we need to do is to take responsibility for the decisions ourselves and then choose leaders amongst us who will then reflect the combination of those individual aspirations in a way that allows us individually to achieve them. So leadership in the future is going to be much more based on people who have a capacity to actively listen, who understand mutual sustainability, that is the connection between the natural environment and community, and who are keen to assist in true custodianship and stewardship of the earth by developing some basic principles, and that, you know, the permaculture principles of caring for the earth, caring for people, and an equitable distribution of resources also means a sharing of decision making. And it also recognises that the diversity we promote and need in our natural environment, we need to imbue in our built environment and also in our social life. And therefore, true custodianship and stewardship in the future is going to be required by all of us individually. And that individual action combined together actually produces a sustainable way of living if people are thinking and acting in a sustainable way individually. So that until we actually understand it fully and act it in our own lives, then how can we bring about that change on a community level? So each moment that we are doing things, we need to develop a habit and adjust our habits to be living sustainably, to have that footprint that we create made smaller, to have the positive impacts we have made wider, and also to walk very softly on the earth.
Here at City Farm, we were chiefly funded through a federal grant for LEAP courses. LEAP stands for Land Care and Environment Action Program. And they were 6-month courses where we took 15 young people who had mostly been long-term unemployed, and they did a permaculture design certificate in horticulture, and they did around 200 hours of rural land care, as well as English and maths and work personal effectiveness and all that sort of stuff. We went on a few camps. So we got the LEAP grant. We also have been funded through the Urban Art grant for graffiti. Healthways has been pretty good at funding us for our gigs and for some of the art type things we were doing in our LEAP courses. But apart from that, most of our funding has actually come through our own initiatives, through our catering mostly, and also we have artists here in residence that pay a small fee each week that goes towards our electricity and water and telephone bill. So we're very much on our own. We have been given gifts from the community. I think Alcoa, and we got our windmill donated through one of our farmers, the men of the trees. Our electric fence for our chooks, we had to keep our chooks safe. They weren't safe at night without us around. And so, yes, we've got a lot of people to be thankful for enabling us to be here in that way for goods and services. But mostly, we are really hoping to develop enterprises ourselves from here to be more self-sufficient. We hope to get a cafe going here. We would like to go into the whole landscape area and work with councils to make foodscapes through the city. So we're constantly trying to think of how we can stand on our own feet and be self-sufficient from here without having to go and ask Cap in Hand for any more money. But of course, when you're a small volunteer group, that is an ambitious project, but we're working on it.
Okay.
But when we came here, apart from the steel, the metal tip we had here, we had a lot of graffiti pieces, illegal pieces on the buildings here, and Neil and Clayton were very much intrigued about graffiti. So we set about getting an urban art grant from the West Australian Department of the Arts, who have been very much involved in trying to get graffiti artists to do legal work and to leave the walls of Perth and the trains alone. So they both went looking for the graffiti artists who could work here. We had the Beyond the Wall program going from this East Perth area, so it wasn't too difficult to track them down. And so mostly they got the people who'd done pieces here to come back and to do beautiful pieces on the walls legally. And we get people from around the world, from the eastern states, you know, local kids who are really into graffiti come and take photos and talk to us. So it's been another way of attracting young people into our project, and it's been extremely successful. We hope to restart the project again and redo our walls, because graffiti is a very ongoing thing. Usually a piece will stay on the wall for a few months and then we'll get somebody else in to do it. I guess we're trying very hard to go out there and talk to young people and see what they want to do. So hopefully in the near future we will have other forms of art being delivered for young people from City Farm. But a bit of research has to go into it, because it's very easy for us to think of what young people should do instead of asking them what they should do. And if this is to continue being a youth project, we hold that concept very valuable to try and see what their needs are. It's hard to know. We're very positive about our project, and the fact is that nothing is constant. And we try very hard not to dwell on the fact that we have a short lifespan, but to constantly be creative and look at it as a piece of life in the city that people can come to and get souls in. So we don't dwell on it. And when we do occasionally, it doesn't do the right thing. It stops us being creative here. So as a policy, we refuse to see ourselves here only for a short time. I think it might have been a tram workshop right in the beginning, but for many, many years it's been a scrap metal yard where they've dismantled engines and, you know, just scrap metal in general. And so we inherited a site that was contaminated, especially with lead. So that was a challenge in itself. So the community garden area, we weren't actually able to allow anyone to garden for at least a year and a half. We had to wait for a tip site to be opened, another hole dug, so that the soil could be right at the bottom of the tip. So a meter of soil has been removed all through the community garden. And then we had it retested, and we're well within the World Health Organization's, you know, requirements for lead. So because our project here is very dependent on organic material to repair the soil, you know, structure here. It's gutless sand, and it's been very damaged over the years through probably compaction and different chemicals going into it. So, and it's coming back. It's coming back. Lots of earthworms. So that's really positive.
When I first got involved with solar power, I remember sitting on my back lawn about 15 years ago, one of the early Arco 30 watt panels and a couple of small electric motors. I hooked them up and off they went. Something hit me. I sort of felt that this is it. This is my life's mission. And over the past 15 years, I've put in dozens of systems, probably approaching 50, 60 systems now, home power systems. And without exception, the people using them are very happy. Over the years, apart from replacing batteries, the solar panels have proven to be extremely reliable. They have a lifespan of over 30 years. Batteries can last for 3, 4, 5 years for the cheaper models, 10, 15, 20 years for the better quality units. inverters and wind generators have design lives of 10 to 20 years. We're talking about long-term investment here in equipment that gives a lot of service, a lot of utility. One of the big problems with using renewable power technology is the initial cost of it. And how do you justify the cost? Because you're trying to compare it against an energy source that has had a tilted playing field added to it. This is called external diseconomy, where you ignore some of the formula for costing the true worth of a commodity so that it is more marketable and so that, politically speaking, it is more amenable to people's minds. Polluted rivers, polluted air, polluted land, sickness, all these things that come about because of the adverse effects of burning excessive amounts of fossil fuels. This has to be recognised by the potential user and purchaser of renewable energy equipment. You are buying something that has intrinsic value-added potential, and it's not just simply a matter of comparing your power bill and trying to say, well, how long is it going to take before I get my money back? You get your money back straight away. You get your money back for the joy of not polluting the earth for future generations. It's already done it. When you pay 15 cents for a kilowatt hour of electricity, do you know what the external diseconomy is? Would you believe that you could really be chewing up 50 cents worth for every 15 cents that you consume because of the cost of the polluted air and the polluted water and the polluted land that is not put into that pricing structure of the electricity supply utility? And of course, you try and talk about this to an economist or to an accountant, and they will not acknowledge it because it's too much for their tiny little mean bean counting brain to put in these unknown quantities. They don't want to know about it. But if you love this place that you are born onto, you have to learn what this means. The cost of polluting our atmosphere, choking people with fossil fuel exhaust fumes that are all around as far as I can see, even in this particularly beautiful city of Perth. It's still here and it's growing rapidly. The true cost of the fossil fuel has to be recognised. Then you compare it with the renewable alternative, which over the years is very, very cheap. In fact, it's so cheap that it's almost a crime that it hasn't been used in a greater fashion to this date. So looking around at all these buildings, how can we do this now? Well, basically most of these structures are facing the wrong way. The windows are facing the wrong way. They're not orientated towards the winter sun. And this is a problem with modern architecture. It's become based more on stylistic issues than logic. And architects have to really get to grips with this. Most of these buildings are energy-guzzling monstrosities that either have to be pulled down or radically modified. Solar access into the building is one of the great problems. The temperature rise is also another problem. The building has to stay stable for the occupants throughout the seasons. And again, the Romans and Greeks knew how to do this. And it's just simply a matter of common sense to look at the sun, look at what we're building, and work out how to make the thing work as an organic machine. Around us, every second, billions of gigawatts of solar power is striking the earth. And the potential for using that and harnessing it is absolutely stupendous. This building itself could run off of the solar energy impacting upon its sides and roof. And by redesigning the way air conditioning works, the ventilation systems, the lighting systems, everything could be changed. And there's certainly no lack of power for us to use. It's a vast treasure trove of energy that can actually change our whole attitudes to living if it's implemented correctly. So where do we start? Well, it's the same with everything. You have to quantify what your needs are and how much power you actually require to do a particular task. Many domestic buildings these days that are hooked up to the grid would use between 10 and 20 kilowatt hours a day. Most of that is wasted. When you actually work out the true requirements using energy conservation techniques, it comes down to less than 5 kilowatt hours a day. Washing machines, fridges, televisions, lighting, everything can be accommodated as long as it's efficient and the best state-of-the-art practice for that particular appliance. Front-loading washing machines, for example, consume a fraction of a top loader because of the way the weight of the washing and the water is being distributed. It's working with gravity instead of against it. Lighting is all fluorescent lighting and high-efficiency compact halogen lamps. Most televisions, electronic equipment and the like are very small consumers of power. But again, if you have a computer system, you should be using a laptop which has a liquid crystal display, which uses less than a tenth of that of a conventional cathode ray tube that you're familiar with in your television sets. A basic renewable energy system is comprised of an energy storage bank of batteries, a number of solar panels or photovoltaic modules, and a wind generator. The energy is converted to a more usable form with an inverter, which changes the static power in the battery to 240 volts alternating current, which you can then use to run your normal appliances. These existing structures can still start to use solar power in meaningful ways for ventilation systems. You can put small fans up into your ceilings to suck air out of the building using a small solar panel mounting on the roof. These are low-cost systems that can be put in for $1,000 to $2,000 for an ordinary domestic residence. You can also run your lighting very efficiently off of solar power for about $3,000, $4,000, maybe $5,000. You can have a renewable energy system running your lighting and perhaps your computer and some other low energy appliances. Once you get to grips with these basic systems, you can then upgrade them and add extra equipment to run larger things. So as your knowledge grows and your trust in the equipment grows, then you do tend to want to use more of it. So all these buildings could start to use it in some way, and it's sad that our politicians haven't put anything in place to encourage people to do this. It seems as if they just don't want to know about it. Many journalists get the wrong end of the stick when they're talking about renewables. They seem to feel that it's all in the future and not now, that there's something that has to be improved. Well, what has to be improved more than anything is our attitude towards what we're doing and our object, the objects of our lives. We're only here for a very short time span, us human beings. You know, the first 20 years of our lives, we're dither brains. The middle 40, we might be productive. The last 20 years, we're going senile. So our productive life is measured in a few decades. And instead of trying to just push everything forward and give it to somebody else, we should be trying to give out our own personal contribution to the earth and for future generations. And we can do this by thinking now, how can we use renewable power in a meaningful way? All the equipment is here. But if you try and judge it in terms of mega power stations and what the politicians talk about, digging huge holes in the earth and burning fossil fuels forever and a day, the whole scaling is wrong and you can't comprehend it like that. You have to look at the small things that you can do as an individual. The cost of a second-hand family car, basically, can almost take you off grid completely. People don't do it because they're mesmerized or just, what's the word? It's more like the lemming syndrome. You copy everybody else, you know. Unless someone else is doing it, you don't do it. Well, you have to become a pioneer. If you want to do something in this day and age, there's enough opportunities for everybody to be a pioneer and make their mark. And it's time for it to happen. There's no excuses anymore. We've got high quality electronic equipment to convert energy from DC to AC. We've got good batteries. We've got incredible solar power module technology. We've got wind generators. It's all here. It's just a matter of our attitudes. And with all this enormous wealth around us, this city must be worth billions, untold billions of dollars. And think how much energy it took to build it. All the fossil energy that it took to make this place. And now it's time to stop it choking on its own effluent and to teach people how to start using this, because this is the basis of all this power in the first place. This is the energy source that is dormant in that fossil fuel energy. That is what created it in the first place. And for the sake of the future, we have to use it now.
Notice there's no children outside anymore. Civilization failed when children got inside the houses. Remember when we were young and you come knock on the door and your mother would say, out, out, out. And you go and knock on the neighbour's door and they come out and say, what do you want? And a bit to eat. And they'd rip the end off a loaf of bread and put it in your hand and say, out, out. No child I ever saw, you know, when I was a child, ever got inside. And the other thing that never got inside ever, you know, this is sort of like, it's like sort of spitting on, out, out, out. Spitting on the cross, you know, no dog ever got inside. You know, you heard stories like from your mother, you used to talk about VD and TB. She had the dog inside in the kitchen. If you saw a dog in someone's house or saw a dog had been in there, you treat it as a disaster. So outside were the children and the dogs. Notice they've got inside everywhere. And they've taken over. They're the cause of huge domestic disruption. Do you realise dog food has gone to the top of the food chain? It's the largest selling grocery item bought in value. Who caused that, do you think? Humans? No, dogs. You notice they've got all this television sign? Dogs? Cats jumping through hoops and wagging their tails at people. They spend, each dog in the West has about 50 times more purchasing power than a child in Africa, and they have much more television time. They're winning. So I got rid of my dog. And I didn't want any more kids, so I started to drink water. But nothing like water today to sterilise you. It's full of estrogens. And it shrivels you up. So I'm out of it all. No dogs, no kids, no telephone, no letters, no mail. Free man, free at last. Yeah. There's little bits of wisdom in all I'm saying, you know, not a lot.
I also represent Denmark because all the other permaculture people in Denmark are so busy with their success that they couldn't find time to come here. But I would stress one thing, and that is that the work done by Tony Anderson on trying to combine rural people and urban people, because we think it's very important that the urban people start to share responsibility with the farmers. Because if they don't share responsibility, the chemical industry in agriculture will just continue. It's the consumer that has the key to development, not the farmer.
I would like to thank Ali and Jeff and Nairi also for bringing that seed of permaculture in Guatemala. And for you who would like to come to Guatemala and see to come and try to help us starting the permaculture scene there, you know, welcome. And thank you again for all your love that you have given me. Thank you.
A lot of people want to go over and help those projects. There's a particular tip if you want to go and work overseas is to actually go and be a student on one of their courses so you can learn with those people. That's a really good thing you can do when you go overseas rather than go and try and tell them what to do.
I would like to say thank you very much to all of you that you give us a lot of experiences that we can get back home with us. But if you think about that, something that can do related to the situation in our country. So, with all of our best wishes and regards to you and to your family, thank you.
Since I've been in Western Australia, I've become incredibly impressed with a number of farmers in the dryland who are now saying, well, we decided to fence this off because we realise that in this area we have a lot of predators using this native vegetation as habitat. And that actually helps us against locusts. That actually, the birds there help us. And we've left that wetlands rather than drain it. We don't need that because the wetlands has birds and frogs, which keep the mosquitoes down, which keep the breeding of insects that would normally attack our crops. So there's far more integration possible and it's actually happening. I've been incredibly heartened by seeing what I've seen since I've been travelling. But I think there's a change because people have realised. Sometimes it's the hip pocket. I mean, the Japanese and the Americans won't buy our wheat or beef if it has certain residue of chemicals. That's forced a lot of farmers to think, oh, God, I have to find out. So then they go to organics or biodynamic or permaculture and see how they can do it. Many people have changed because they're concerned for their children. One of their family may get leukemia or may have skin disease and may have a problem and they've traced it to the chemicals on the farm. That's often a precipitator for change. And some, of course, have changed because of ideology, a recognition that a part of the earth and their heart and soul has been touched by seeing what's happened, so we have to change for the sake of future generations.
But my aim is when I finally get the buildings done, is to be able to house people here for 2 weeks at a time, like up to 30 people here, and have them all using different styles of compost toilets and have them all having showering under different types of appropriate technology, you know, solid different showers, and just having demonstrations but practical, everything being appropriate to the area, and also showing people that it's not lowering the standard of living either. So many people think back to basics. Well, it's not back to basics, it's forward to sustainability.
The context of human society in the future is really going to be one of relearning the land ethic, really bringing back the land into our community, and the land being nature and agriculture, organic living. And by permeating that through, we'll suddenly find that the hierarchy of settlement that we live in is very important, that the village and the hamlet are critical importance to the city, and that the city itself will be part of a smaller footprint over the wider environment that will actually start to bring back the forest and the agriculture into the city. We'll start pulling down fences and finding that we've got much larger areas of land available. And that's going to be important for our children to learn about that way of living because our footprint at the moment on the world is huge.
Children have the capacity, given responsibility, tools and the ability to be creative, to completely design age appropriate and to learn the elements and techniques of design, like gardening, like swales, like appropriate technology. And in my observation and experience, it's a completely underrated. Schools are really not utilised nearly enough for bringing children into that role of responsibility as our future caretakers and leaders.
We're very pleased with our last 10, 11 years. We've been able to go out into the community, local community, and also go as far as Esperance, Kalgoorlie, and north of Perth, teaching permaculture to people who want to know, and the people who want to know are getting more and more and more every day, and that's a real blessing.
We're very positive about our project, and the fact is that nothing is constant. And we try very hard not to dwell on the fact that we have a short lifespan, but to constantly be creative and look at it as a piece of life in the city that people can come to and get souls in.
A timeless energy source for a new power age. That's basically what it's all about. Those who struggle against it will go down in history as traitors to the future of humanity. Short-sighted individuals that for quick gain and political expediency were prepared to destroy something that has evolved for millions of years, and I'm talking about nature herself. She needs to be defended by you and I, from our hearts, from our souls. And that is why we have to use nature's power station.
So in a sense, permaculture does what everyone says. You give a person a fish and they eat for a day. You give them a fishing line, teach them to fish. But in this case, it's a balanced diet. And, of course, the environmental repair.
I would put significant amounts of money on not seeing either the dismantling of the Berlin Wall or apartheid within my lifetime. Both happened with quite dramatic suddenness when the political and social conditions were right. I think it is possible, and in my optimistic moods I hope that it is true, that future historians will see this as a time when we moved from an age of unprecedented material expansion to an age in which we were aware of ecological limitations and started to change our behaviour significantly.
We've had a tremendous representation from countries. I think almost 30 countries were represented at this conference, and the richness of the experience of all these people coming together and sharing has been most stimulating and positive.
I'm extremely proud of the permaculture movement. There's never been anything like it in the history of mankind. Could we go for it? There's nothing else worth going for. When the kids say, what did you do in the war, Mummy? So I did a permaculture course, darling. Yeah, I think so. You know, it is a bit of sanity is needed. A lot of sanity is needed. A lot of skepticism, a lot of sanity.